Good morning. We are so happy to welcome you here this morning at All Souls for another online worship experience this week, the start of a new season, and so our water communion service. I am Reverend Carolyn Patierno, and I serve All Souls as a senior minister, and joining me this morning is Reverend Caitlin O'Brien, associate minister, Perry Montrose, the Director of Faith Formation, our ministerial intern, Ann Kadlecek, our music director, Tanya Lehman, as well as the Board of Trustees and the Martin family. As ever, Jesse Edwards is tending to all of the technical details this week, and we thank him also this week for his photography that you'll be seeing a little later on. And thanks to Tammy, as ever, for the beautiful slides. I invite you to enter into a centering spirit, perhaps with a deep breath, perhaps with a moment of quiet and silence. Hear these wise words by the poet Kathleen Spivak. The title of her poem is "The Water Gives Up Its Counsel." Looking into the water, stay, O ripples, just so. The water widening and widening, and the small thought transitory. The pure curve of the current, flow with it, my simple self. Flow with the call of its curling forever. Recover, forgo the sharp sadness. How we grasp, though we wish it not so. Will is nothing to water. Time to learn to let go. Let us let go. Let us let in the spirit of Sunday morning. Welcome to All Souls, where all souls are welcome. You are joyfully called to worship. And we begin by joining our voices from away and yet near. We join our voices in singing the hymn, "I've Got Peace Like a River," and Tanya will lead us. Tanya.
Thank you so much, Tanya. Some years ago, we began a tradition of having the youngest among us light the chalice at our annual water communion service. As of today, the youngest soul among us was born to the Martin family in April. Tanique and Gabby will assist Holden Thomas in lighting our chalice this morning. Please speak with them the words in our order of worship.
We would like to introduce Holden Thomas Martin, born April 17th.
Why a flaming chalice? The question comes. It is the cup of life, we answer. A cup of blessings overflowing. a cup of water to quench our spirit's thirst.
Thank you, Holden, and Tanique, and Gabby. And Holden, welcome aboard. This week is the solemn anniversary of the September 11th attacks, 19 years ago. We pause to remember the lives lost and the friends and family members and coworkers and acquaintances impacted by those losses. And we as citizens take stock of the political and military actions that followed that terrible day. We light a candle for peace. For the steps, big and small, that each of us can take to promote peace. May we hold ourselves to this always. Amen.
Our story today is a folktale. It's from India and from China. There are different versions of this story. We're calling this one The Water Bearer's Garden. An elderly Chinese woman had two large pots, each hung on the ends of a pole that she carried across her neck. One of the pots had a crack in it. At the end of the long walks from the stream up the hill to the house, the cracked pot arrived only half full, while the other pot was perfect and always delivered a full portion of water. She made this trip every day for 2 full years. Each time bringing home only 1.5 pots of water.
Of course, the perfect pot was proud of its accomplishments, perfect in the task for which it was made. But the poor cracked pot was ashamed of its own imperfection and miserable that it could only do half of what it had been made to do. After 2 years of what it perceived to be bitter failure, it spoke to the woman one day by the stream. "I am ashamed of myself, and I want to apologize to you."
"Why?" asked the woman. "What are you ashamed of?"
The pot responded, "I have been able for these past 2 years to deliver only half my load because this crack in my side causes water to leak out all the way back to your house. Because of my flaws, you have to do all this work and you don't get the full value from your efforts. I am ashamed of myself because this crack in my side causes water to leak out all the way back."
The woman felt sorry for the cracked pot, and in her compassion, she said, "As we return to the house, I want you to notice the beautiful flowers along the path."
Indeed, as they went up the hill, the old cracked pot took notice of the sun warming the beautiful wild flowers on the side of the path, and this cheered it some. But at the end of the trail, it still felt sad because it had leaked out half its load. And so again, the pot apologized to the woman for its failure.
The woman said to the pot, "Did you notice that there were flowers only on your side of the path, but not on the other pot's side? That's because I have always known about your flaw. I planted flower seeds on your side of the path, and every day while we walk back from the stream, you've watered them. For 2 years, I have been able to pick beautiful flowers to decorate my table. Without you, being just the way you are. I would not have this beauty to grace my house.
We all have our own unique flaws. We are all cracked pots. But it's the cracks and flaws we each have that make our lives together interesting and rewarding.
Don't be afraid of your flaws or those of others, for our flaws can bring about beauty. In our weakness, we may find our strength. So ends our story.
Thank you, Perry and Anne. That's a story that I love hearing over and over again because it reminds us of all of the personalities and flaws and the wonderful things that each of us brings to a sense of community that we treasure, that we celebrate every year, especially on this particular Sunday. And this year is no different. So, flowers and flaws and joy and sorrow, we gather up. Hermann Hesse said that water is the voice of life, the voice of being, the voice of perpetual becoming. I'm so grateful to Arlene Stoltz, who introduced that beautiful quote to me. And it is one, as many of you know, that was shared in the little vials of water that you received at the Water Communion yesterday. And so in this time of perpetual becoming, perhaps the water gathered and shared at this year's Water Communion will be for us a reminder of the strength and the flaws of our communion. As we enter this new season, we also enter into what I am calling the pandemic's even sadder moment, the part that brings the collective realization that we have miles to go before we can breathe and talk and sing unmasked and in each other's company once again. But we can do hard things. As we do, we give thanks for the ways that we are able to be together, like a differently conceived water communion that we celebrated yesterday, like the differently conceived way we are worshiping here this morning or whenever it is that you are joining in. In all things, we give thanks. We give thanks for water, so scarce now in the places where fires rage. Water, so powerful now in the places where storms blew through. Our bodies, half, over half of our physical selves is water. With the water we gather for our water communion, we dedicate our children and we bless the dying, honoring the circle of life. Water as saving element, water as ferocious reminder of the power of soft things. Water as life-giving, water as blessing. For all of these, for water, we give thanks. The water communion ritual was conceived by a group of women, activists all, who gathered annually for reunion and restoration. They each brought a small bit of water from home, and they poured the water into a common bowl as a reminder that together we are stronger. We need to be stronger than ever, than we ever imagined right about now. We need all souls to be stronger than we ever imagined. And we can't get complacent about nurturing the strength we'll need in the months ahead. Remember, we can do hard things, and we give thanks and rejoice as we do. In 2011, to the water communion ritual, we added pies for peace on the 10th anniversary of 9/11. It was a way to hold close the necessity and the joy of the feast, even and perhaps especially in the midst of injustice, danger, and anxiety. In all things, we must tend to joy and to hope. In this way, we nurture our strength. And so I invite you to witness a visual reflection of yesterday's water communion and pies for peace.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesse. And thank you for your beautiful photographs. We will conclude as we always do by adding the water that remains from last year's water communion, symbolizing the ongoing nature and power of community. And may the congregation say, Amen. Amen. Tanya is going to sing for us a musical meditation that the choir has sung in the past and that she will create a choir of one in sharing it this year. Thank you, Tanya.
When I'm weak.
Thank you, Tanya, for yet another beautiful interpretation for musical meditation. You raise our spirits week after week after week. Thank you. At this first service of a new season, the congregation always enters into a renewed covenant with our Board of Trustees. Your board is gathered here today on your screen to do so. And so I'd like to introduce you to these leaders who are giving their time and their energy to serve in a most unusual time, from a building project to a pandemic to a very trying time in our country in general. We are so grateful that you are making the time to serve. Thank you. I'm going to introduce your Board of Trustees, and when I do, they will raise a hand in greeting so you can see who they are. Sally McGee is serving as your president. Tom Lesko is serving as your vice president. Tina Dubosc is serving as your treasurer. And David Burnside is serving as your secretary, all of whom make up our executive committee. At-large board members include Katrina Burkow, Bruce Cummings, Sean Elliott, and Karen Ethier-Waring. Brad Mock is also serving, but he is missing from your frame, but we thank him as well. Jesse Edwards is going to speak on behalf of the congregation. He's going to come out from behind the curtain for this occasion. We thank you for that, Jesse, and I hope you will all join from home. Thank you, Board. Let us enter into covenant with you.
We, the members of All Souls, express to our Board of Trustees our gratitude for your investment in our community, our trust in your integrity and wisdom, our support of your leadership, and our enduring loyalty to the mission and vision of this church. We pledge to do what is within our power to make your stewardship of our shared future an experience of discovery, accomplishment, and growth.
We, as members of the Board of Trustees, acknowledge and accept the trust that you have placed in us.
We covenant to deal forthrightly and honestly with each other and with you.
To keep foremost in our hearts the congregation's mission to create a welcoming, caring, and justice-seeking community within and beyond our walls.
Together may we make this congregation a beacon of compassion and a witness to the power of love.
We now enter into our offering. It is the custom at All Souls to use the offering during water communion as a good neighbor offering to support the work for peace taking place in our community. This year, the offering supports Writer's Block, Inc., a local organization with the mission of arming young voices with the power of pen and prose, reinforcing teamwork, accountability, and responsibility, igniting social change on the page and stage. This group fosters speaking truth to power, promoting the change that can ultimately move us toward the peaceful world that we seek. We began this collection yesterday in the parking lot, along with the water ritual. If you missed it, you can donate today by Venmo, PayPal, check, or online banking. Just be sure to put GNO, the letters GNO for Good Neighbor Offering, in the memo if you would like your donation to go to Writer's Block, Inc. We know this continues to be a time of financial hardship for many. We invite you to give in whatever amount makes sense for you now. And we are very grateful. Let us prepare for giving by saying these words together. We give to the work of Writer's Block, Inc. To be good neighbors, we support the work that creates the greater good. With this offering, we remember to extend our reach beyond these walls. The offering will be gratefully received. All you have given, all you have sacrificed. Thank you.
Thank you. Each week we pause to pay attention to the joy and sorrow that we experienced in the week just passed. At this time, you may choose to share in the YouTube chat so that your joy or sorrow may be witnessed this morning. If you'd like your words spoken in the service, please send a message to the beloved community email address by 2 p.m. on Thursdays. And now, as we light candles of intention, let us prepare our hearts for what is shared and enter into a communion of silence. Blessed be. Let us enter a space of prayer and meditation. We bring to our mindful attention this morning the troubling news of destructive wildfires in the western United States, particularly in Oregon, California, and Washington. We heard this week from Mary, who asks that we keep her granddaughter and her granddaughter's husband in our thoughts as they were evacuated from their home in Oregon. And we heard from Mary Lou last week that her daughter's family had lost their home in California. And other souls I know are worried for loved ones in the path of these fires. Let us hold close our siblings in these regions, for whom there may be no electricity, for whom the air may be painful to breathe, and for whom home and safety are at risk. We direct our good wishes to the first responders and to all who are tenaciously working for the common good. And we hold tenderly this morning the intentions shared in our service chat, as well as the gratitudes and the worries held close to the heart. It's healing to know that not one of us is alone, that loving community can both hold our sorrows and amplify our celebrations. It is in that deep, deep spirit that together we say, Amen. I hope that you'll join in singing with Tanya a favorite hymn for Water Communion Sunday, Shall We Gather at the River? And know that as you sing the rousing chorus, you are in good company. Thank you, Tanya. Now, as Reverend Carolyn extinguishes our chalice, please speak with me the words in our order of worship. Our service has ended, but our work is not yet done. May our spirits be renewed and our purpose resolved as we meet the challenges of the week. Our chalice flame is extinguished until once again ignited by the strength of our communion.
I invite you to place your hand upon your heart and reach out to the community just beyond. This is a meditation that you are invited every year to speak as you bake your pies for our Pies for Peace celebration. And so we share it here and now. From the garden to the kitchen, through our hands, to the table. The feast we make with the pies we bake, may they nourish, may the feast nourish what is bitter with what is sweet. May we hold close the ways that we are connected to the land and to each other. Let there be love. Let there be plenty. Let there be peace, and let this peace begin with us. Shalom, salam, blessed be, and amen. Amen. Peace be with you all. Before our postlude, Perry has Just a couple of announcements I hope you will stay tuned for. Perry.
Our food drive has new collection days and times. You may drop off baby food and diapers this month on Thursdays, 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. and Fridays, 5 to 5:30 p.m. when you can stay for our Black Lives Matter witness that happens every Friday evening. After the service today at 11 a.m. is our Zoom teacher orientation. If you have not received the link for that, please reach out to me. And next Sunday, September 20th, is our first pre-K through ninth grade faith formation session of the new season. And it will be in person in the All Souls parking lot at 11:30. We can't wait to see you then. But until then, now enjoy Bill's postlude and go in peace with pie.